today. We have Andy Miller from Andy Miller Andy Miller. He has his own company, same name. And he has a podcast. He's going to tell you all about it. All I'm here to do is embarrass him with one of his fun facts.
Oh, good.
Andy Miller. He memorized and performed the dance from Napoleon Dynamite at his high school talent show before the movie was even on wide release. So most of his high school thought he was Napoleon.
True story.
Okay. Andy Miller.
All right. I had to download the movie on LimeWire to get that done, so don't tell the FBI. Hi, I am super happy to be here. Thanks for having me. Can you hear me all right? All right, projecting. I've never been to the South, like ever. I did a talk in Kentucky though, and they said they were the South, but they're not. So anyway, I'm getting fatter and that's great. We had a really good meal last night. I'm gonna actually, I think, try this. Sorry. All right. I need freedom of the controls. So that's me. I look like a miniature person with a regular cup of coffee. So most people call me Andy J. Pizza now. I don't really know how that happened, but anyway, I just went with it. So I'm Andy J. Pizza. You can find me on Instagram and Twitter at Andy J. Pizza. And actually, because it's the future, we don't have like flying cars, but what we do have are domain names that end in .pizza. So you can find my work at andyj.pizza, for real. If you go there, you're gonna find this. This is my illustration portfolio. I'm not gonna go super deep into like every piece that I ever made and all that kind of jazz and try to convince you that I'm really good at making pictures. I'm not gonna do that. I will just say that I've done some work for clients like Google and Nickelodeon, and then recently I finally achieved my all-time dream and worked with, if you look up there, Hefty Trash Bags. So go ahead, it's fine. You can, I know, it was a good project. This is some other recent work for band posters, and actually was thrilled to work with Nutella because I'm obsessed, and I really would have been paid in Nutella, but they didn't do that. So I also have a podcast, so I'm also a podcaster now. It's called Creative Pep Talk, where I give pep talks for creative people, and that's the whole story. Today, if you like today, that's a good taste of the podcast. If you hate today, don't listen to my podcast. You will not enjoy it. I don't know if this was a good decision or not, but I'm a big fan, massive fan, of making a fool out of yourself in public. This is me at Disney World a few months ago. We'll just watch this video real quick. Terrible. Pretty good move. That's almost done. Let's watch it one more time. No professional training, if you'll believe it. The funny thing is like nobody stops and looks at it. They're just like, yeah, it's Disney World. We know people are crazy. Okay, to the talk. I know I told you this was gonna be called Playing Hot and Cold with the Universe, which sounds epic and amazing. And it's still very similar talk, but I decided to give it a new title. Obsta-tunities. It doesn't have the same mystical quality, but I did put like stars and stuff around it to give it that vibe. It sounds more like a mom blog post or something. Like, but I like it, and there's a principle here that I want to talk about. When I was looking back through my story, I noticed this trend that happened like over and over and over again, where there was this creative work that I wanted to be doing, which is represented by the trophy, and there was always this brick wall in the way of doing the work that I felt like I needed to be doing at any given moment. And it took some like creative problem solving to get over that wall. And I would finally get to the other side and I'd be making that creative work that I wanted to be doing, but everybody was preoccupied with the creative work that it took to get over the obstacle. And they're like, we don't care about this other stuff you're doing. They wanted to go back to the thing that was kind of a compromise, kind of a haphazard way of getting over this challenge. And today I just want to talk about why I think this principle is potentially a game changer, and I think it's a game changer for me, and I hope that it's encouraging to you. And I'm gonna just tell a story to kind of illustrate this. So when I was in high school, I went to high school in Southern Indiana, and there wasn't, especially in my house, there wasn't a lot of culture. I would say like the cultural artifacts that we did have were things like one random Phil Collins CD. And then we had the copy of the movie Grease as well. That was most of my, I'm not dissing Grease. You guys kind of got sensitive about that one. Anyway, that's a good movie. But the cultural items in my kind of purview were Jones Soda, which was really tasty. Got that from the local Kroger. Jim Carrey, I watched all of his movies lots of times. Ja Rule, holla, you know. I listened to a lot of Ja Rule, I don't know. And it wasn't until I was in high school that, this poster, by the way, was made by the Decoder Design Concern. They're phenomenal designers. But it wasn't until high school that I started to kind of taste some culture that really moved me. And I got into this band Modest Mouse, and I got into indie bands, and it was the first time ever in my life that I could see kind of breadcrumbs into a future that I actually wanted to go to, because like all the normal things that normal people do, I was not fantastic at, still not. And and in art even, like I wasn't the best drawer, I don't know. Is that a word? I don't think it's a word, but you get it. I wasn't even the best at drawing in high school. So I just didn't really have an idea of where I wanted to go until I found this band, and they had this back catalog of these amazing screen printed band posters. And it was just like blowing my mind. And for the first time, I had an idea of what I wanted to do in college and maybe after that. And so I wanted to go into illustration and design. So I wanted to go into illustration design, and right when I graduated, my dad got transferred to a job in the UK. And so I took the opportunity to study over there, which I thought would be amazing, which in many ways it was. But the problem was, I went there to screen print band posters, and that culture had yet to go there. So there was no screen printed band posters. I could literally, nobody would let me screen print onto paper. Like I would go to all of the local shops and I'd be like, I want to make these posters like on paper? Like they only did t-shirts and they just didn't even know anything about screen printing on paper. And then in the college, there was a screen printing department that was only for the fine art students. So they wouldn't let us, you know, grimy designers in and messing with their whatever they were doing. And so I had no way. I went to college, I was stuck in England, and I couldn't do any of the work that I wanted to be doing. And it wasn't until my third year in school, which is actually the final year there, that I just thought, I'm gonna force it. I'm gonna figure out some way, some weird way of getting over this barrier and getting to the work that I wanna be doing. And I came up with this idea, the Indie Rock Coloring Book, and honestly, I will get, like, truthfully, I thought it was really stupid. I thought it was a dumb idea. I thought it was just a compromise way of getting to work with these bands that I was so obsessed with, and maybe it would somehow shoehorn into doing the work that I really wanted to do. And so I want to take just a quick minute. I always do this anytime I have a chance, and I have a place in the public view to publicly apologize. So if I do the math right, that was 2009, and I really do think that I may have started the onslaught of adult coloring books. So I don't know. Either you're welcome or sorry. I don't know. One of those two. But back to the story. The thing is that when I was looking back and I was preparing for this talk, I kind of noticed that, you know, the indie rock coloring book launched my career in a way that doing more band posters never would have. And I think that, you know, when the coloring book came out, Chronicle Books published it in 2009. It was on E's morning show, like it was in the USA Today gift guide for the year, just like crazy random stuff that if I had been able to make screen printed band posters, they never would have had that reach. And so this thing that I thought was just a complete compromise, a way of getting to where I wanted to go, was really a bigger creative opportunity than if I could just do what I wanted to. So I think that if I say Matisse, I'm assuming most of you are gonna think of his cut paper work, right? That might be because I incepted that idea into your brain with this slide. But I'm assuming, like, you know, I'm a massive fan of his cut paper work, and that came from not a massive breakthrough where all the planets aligned and it came to, and it was this amazing moment. It was really an obstacle that became an opportunity, because he was oil painting, and it wasn't until he was severely ill and bedridden that he started doing this cut paperwork, because it's all that he could do. So he used that obstacle as a real opportunity for breakthrough. And we probably are talking about him today because of that work. And so this is why I'm talking about this today. I genuinely believe that, you know, I work with tons of creative people. I do an online class. I used to teach at an art school, and I run into people all the time that refuse to be honest about the work that they really would like to be doing, or what really gets them out of bed in the morning, what they're passionate about. And they always have, you know, 50 reasons why it's impossible for them to do that work. There's always an excuse. There's always an obstacle. And today, my whole point is that maybe that could be a good thing. What's he talking about? I'll tell you. I think that creativity is connecting the unconnected. I think that's my favorite definition of creativity. It's the idea that if you can draw a line between two dots that seem contradictory, that's creativity. That's the definition of it. It's like seeing a path where no one else saw a path. That's being creative. And I think if there's a paved road, somebody's already been there. If the work that you want to be doing is incredibly easy to do, if there's a major and 65,000 tutorials online and, you know, grants and all kinds, it's just the easiest thing in the world to do, people have already done it. It's already been done. It's not left for that creative opportunity. And so I want to just talk a little bit about the biggest obstacle in my life that I've had to overcome. It's a work in progress. And I want to start by allowing you all to appreciate the beauty that is the equilateral triangle. Now, I know that when I put that up there, you guys instantly saw that triangle and were like, equilateral triangle. Because we get so much practice on a daily basis of identifying the various types of triangles as it pertains to our very survival. Right? Hope there's no math teachers in here. But when I would be in geometry class looking at the equilateral triangle, I wasn't thinking, 60 degrees on every point. I was thinking, pizza. That's my favorite triangle. It's the most delicious one for sure. And when I would be doing my timed times table tests, like, you can barely say that in the amount of time they would give you to do the tests. You know, and I'm sure you guys see all this and you're instantly work out these equations. And I could do that, but we don't have time up here right now. That's not the talk. So, but when I would do these and I would sit down and they would be like, all right, go. I would have this other thing happening where I'd be looking at the numbers and they would start to have like personalities and stories, and number one, you know, not much of a personality. He's just been born. He's not really that self-actualized. Number four, starting to get some hobbies. He's, you know, he's into football. Three's jealous of four because of the hobbies. There's a lot of drama between those siblings. Seven is like not too old, not too young, pretty cool. Like, what am I talking about right now? Is anybody asking that? What's happening? But you can see that, like, with all that drama going on, it's incredibly difficult to finish your test. And so if you haven't gathered, I have ADHD. These are some of the things that you get labeled when you have ADHD. And they were all true to some degree for sure. Distracted, unproductive, hyper, talkative. I remember, like, when I was in school, several teachers who had no connections to each other all came up with this on their own, that tomorrow, Andy, you are not talking. Zero. Don't open your mouth. Now, the funny thing is, though, is that they didn't know that I was already mastering the ancient art of obstatunity. And I was more expressive on the days I couldn't talk than any other day. I was doing hand gestures and all kinds of stuff. They never gave me that punishment again. And so for me, my whole life has been, you know, because I, to be honest, like, my mom has ADHD, and that was a really a challenging thing, and it made it challenging for her to be a regular adult. And that affected her parenting, and I remember just watching her and thinking, like, I don't want to do that. I want to do better than that. But I also knew that I was just like her. And so even from an early age, I knew that it was a real obstacle, and it still is a real obstacle. But I've taken a different path. I'm a freelance illustrator. It's kind of a different approach to being a person. All of these things, all the things that they would call me, all these weaknesses, these obstacles, turned into opportunities because I wasn't distracted. I was creative, and I wasn't unproductive. I was a multitasker. I'm such a multitasker that sometimes I'm getting stuff done that doesn't need to get done. And then there's other stuff that needs to get done that doesn't. But I'm really energetic, and I'm not talkative. I'm a podcaster. So eat that, Mrs. Curry. I'm getting paid to talk, all right? Yes! Actually, if Mrs. Curry is watching this, I'm sorry. I've loved you. You are a great teacher. There's another story that I think illustrates this idea of overcoming your personal obstacles to do the work that you want to be doing. Because I think, you know, from all the people I've worked with, people have these stories that they tell themselves or labels that they've been given that convince them that they'll never be able to do the things that maybe they really like to do. And I think this story is one of my favorite examples of that. So there was a guy named Alexander Fleming, and he was this lab technician, and he was kind of notorious for being a mess, kind of being a disaster, messy lab, didn't clean up after himself. You know, I imagine these stories like Bob, the other lab technician, coming along and be like, damn it, come on, like, get the petri dishes out of the sink. You're never gonna have a scientific breakthrough if you keep your lab in this disarray. Come on, Alex. And he's upset, you know, goes home that night, like, Bob's right. Like, I'm never gonna, how am I ever, I went into the wrong profession. What am I doing? He's like, I think I just need some time off. I need to take a breather, step away, get some headspace, and then come back afresh. And he did it with such swiftness that he didn't even clean up his lab. He just left it. And then weeks later when he came back, growing in the petri dish with the disease that he was studying was penicillin. And it was the first antibiotic that was discovered. And I just love that story, this idea that this real shortcoming turns into saving millions of people's lives. And you can also use that, I think, in your own life, where if you're messy, I'm a little bit messy, you can be like, you don't know whose life I might be saving. Like, let's see what happens. Give it a few weeks. And so we take a leaf from the book of the great Michael Scott. Any Michael Scott fans? Yes, me too. That, and it's from The Office, if you don't know. And he goes into his job interview at corporate with David Wallace. And David Wallace says, Michael, what are your weaknesses? And Michael says, I work too hard, I care too much, and sometimes I'm too invested in my job. And he's like, okay, what are your strengths? He's like, I just told you. So what could grow on your shortcomings, these things that you've convinced yourself are the things that stop you from doing the things that you really want to be doing? The obstacle that stops you from doing it their way might just be the reason you do it in a way that's never been done. How? Okay, Andy, nice stories. They were cute. But how do you actually do it? This is my practical step-by-step process. Number one is get honest. Lots of times when I'm working with people, they won't even admit the work that they want to do. They won't even be honest with themselves about the work they want to do. And I think it's actually pretty helpful to ask yourself if money, time, talent, and luck weren't an issue, if they weren't on the table, if those weren't obstacles in the way, what would you want to do? What work would you want to be doing? And then step two is do the exact opposite of that. Name the obstacles. Get honest about the other side. Like, what are the things that are legitimately in the way of stopping you from doing the creative work that you want to be doing? And then number three is take that obstacle and use your excuse. I like that. And I don't mean just use your excuse and run away from the work. I mean literally take that obstacle and turn it into the opportunity to do an actual creative act. So if there's a brick wall, paint your best mural on it. Use it as a substrate. Mountain, sculpture. Water, you can engineer a bridge. Is that what you do? I don't know the verb on what to do to a bridge, but you can make a great bridge. This is one of my favorite examples of Obsta-tunity. Is anybody counting how many times I say that? I'd love to know. I'll go back through the tapes. This is my wife Sophie's work from when she was in college. She was a fine art embroiderer, and she made these really elaborate, time-intensive, beautiful pieces of fine art, and they were just phenomenal, and it was actually one of the reasons I fell in love with her, is I loved her work so much. And when we started to get serious, and I mean like we just started talking about our future, she told me that she loved the embroidery, but her real dream was to have lots of kids and be a mom, and she just was really looking forward to that season of her life, and so we did. We had 14 children. just kidding. We had three children, which is still a ton. So many children. She loves being a mom. It has definitely fulfilled her in all kinds of different ways. But, you know, a few years into it, she realized, if she was honest with herself, that there was a creative itch that she really was desperate to scratch. And she knew also that she couldn't go back to doing that time-intensive work. She couldn't go back to doing that embroidered, time-intensive, paint everywhere, working for hours and hours and hours on these projects. It was not realistic to do that and raise kids at the same time. And so she literally used that obstacle as an opportunity. She used being a mom as inspiration and created these absolutely beautiful animal ear headbands. And I can honestly say, I do truly believe that they're the best animal ear headbands in the world. They're gorgeous, they're high quality, and you can buy them for $10.99. No. Well, if you want to see them, you can follow her at the Thread House on Instagram. But she sold thousands of these things. And it's probably, in a lot of ways, success that she would never have tasted if she just followed the same path, if the path was easy to make that creative work. She would be still doing the embroidered work. And so it was really a complete breakthrough. And I know, because I have all of these things, you know, things like ADHD can often feel truly like a prison, like you're trapped in your own DNA, unable to break through. And I know that location sometimes can feel like that when, you know, I live in the Midwest, and I know sometimes I feel like all the actions in LA and New York and that thing's gonna mean that I can't matter in my little, you know, niche that I'm in, or it could be personal decisions, it could be health. I know that all of these things can legitimately feel like being trapped. So I wanna just talk about this guy real quick. Jesse Crimes, that cannot be his real name. He's famous for being in prison. He made this mural out of newspaper, plastic spoons, hair gel, and on federal prison bed sheets. And he would make them panel by panel and then mail them to his girlfriend. And then when he got out, he assembled the whole thing, and it went viral, went all over the internet, had a massive impact. And I think in this literal prison, this literal physical obstacle with no materials, here's a guy who made an impact with a mural, probably in a way that the people that had everything going for them as mural artists would only dream of. And he's not the only one. Some of the greatest creations ever came from a prison cell. We have all the Arthur lore started in a prison cell. Don Quixote, classic. Lil Wayne's verse on the remix of Drake's Light Up was recorded in prison over the phone. And I haven't heard it, but I'm sure it's groundbreaking. I know, if I know anything about Wheezy, I know he brings it. So just think of that. And I think that great creative careers are like vaccines, that the answer is often found in the problem itself. And so I'm trying to start a new hashtag called Yes Excuses. It's a little bit more confusing, but what I mean is that it's quite possible that your excuse, the reason why you can't do it like the other guy, is the same thing that's gonna make you do it your own unique way. It's the same, and I know it sounds cute, but I really do believe this. And I think, like, with all the noise, there's so much stuff being put out on the internet and put out there, and, you know, everything's been done 85,000 times, right? And I think one way to possibly get a competitive edge is to run towards those obstacles, because maybe they could act as signposts to the real opportunities for creativity. And I think the bigger the obstacle, the more creative the solution has to be. So that's all I've got. Thanks.